I hurt, I don't understand, I don't belong, and I'm not enough. So I hurt has to do with the basic response to grief that all of us feel. The physiological response, I'm not hungry, or I'm hungry all the time, I can't sleep, I'm afraid of the dark. Children are anxious to go out to school. There was a big dog that lived next door that they really liked, but now they're timid to walk by the gate because they're afraid of this dog. Things like that. Children can't say, as adults do, when they're grieving, that they'll talk about, maybe they'll, you know, people talk about the emptiness in their stomach, or if they're medically inclined, they'll talk about their epigastric distress, you know. Children don't talk about that. They'll say, maybe I have a tummy ache. So it's the children's way of experiencing the grief that, or the manifestations of grief that many of us feel. So when children are hurting inside, they need comfort. They need people to be able to say to them, yeah, I know that, that really hurts. I feel that way too when I think of Johnny. So this sense of acknowledging the hurt, comforting the child, and indicating that he's not alone, because we feel that way too. Parents are very good at that. They're probably the best people to do that. I don't understand is because children simply do not have the developmental capacity yet. Not that any of us ever do get there, but to really understand death, or to understand what's happening. Why are all these people here? And why is everybody crying? And why does everybody keep bringing food? You know, just little things that children find confusing because it's irregular for their lifestyle. And so helping children to understand what is happening, why we're doing what we're doing, helping children to understand what's going to happen if they go to the funeral, giving them options, giving them choices, making it clear. And when we give choices to children, not to say things like, now, if you go to the funeral, you will see Johnny will be in a special box called a casket. He'll be lying very still. He's not sleeping, though. It looks like he's sleeping, but he's not really sleeping because Johnny has died. Now, you may see lots of people crying, and that's because they're sad, and it's okay if you want to cry too. Or, if you'd rather, you could go to Aunt Mary's, and I know Aunt Mary made a chocolate cake this morning, and I know she's got cookies in the fridge for you. Well, what kind of choice is that for a little kid? So we have to give them choices that are equally weighted and clear in ways that children can actually make a choice. So helping children understand and make choices. Parents are pretty good at that, too. Then when children feel as if I don't belong, and that's often because when a child dies, there's a lot of attention. Well, when a child is sick initially, a lot of attention on the sick child. And parents simply don't have time or the wherewithal to think about all the things that need to be done, though they are trying to do all of that. In our study with fathers just now, fathers say that the sick child takes up all of their time and energy. Then they try to devote energy to their other children, but they have no energy left for them, the mother and father together as a couple. So children, the healthy children, often feel as if I don't belong here anymore. Johnny gets all the attention. I don't get any. And then after the death, you know, I've heard many children say, I really should have been the one who died because my brother was much smarter than I was. He never got in trouble and I'm in trouble all the time. Or he was really good at sports and I really can't do anything. So it probably would have been better if I would have been the one. So when children feel as if they don't belong anymore, they don't have a place, that they're not part of the family in the way that they used to be. In that case, they need a lot of information, a lot of support, a lot of encouragement, a lot of comfort to help them feel as if they're part of things. So giving children concrete things to do, instead of sending them to their room or sending them out to play, would you like to help pass the cookies now that, you know, the minister and his wife are visiting? You don't want to do the cookies? Well, how about you take them a napkin you know, so that they feel like they're part of it. Doesn't need to be big things, just little things. Or give the sick child, how would you like to give Johnny a sip of water? How would you like to rub Johnny's hand? Because that makes him know you're here. Taking pictures of the family so that at some point in the future, the bereaved children will look back and realize that they were there. They were part of what happened. Then the last one is the most distressing one, and that's the one where children feel as if I'm not enough. I'm not enough, similar to before, I'm not enough because mommy and daddy are so upset and doesn't matter what I do. I can't make them happy anymore, so I think it's pretty right. I should have been the one who died. I'm just not enough in comparison to the one who died. And I've had children tell stories about how in their families, even before the ill child got sick, they felt as though they weren't enough because they felt they weren't the favorite child and another child was. So one of the best things I've learned for families to do in this regard, make all of the children feel special in some way. Parents see the differences in their children. Not all children are the same. So it's important to find something special about each child. And admittedly, that's sometimes difficult if there's a problem child, but find something special in each child so they each have something special. Many times I do my interviews by visiting families in their homes. And when I do that, after the death of a child, parents always want to show me pictures of their child who died, his baseball trophy, her doll collection, all kinds of things, but particularly the pictures. And I've noticed over the years that there are two ways of doing that. Sometimes families will say to me, as they're talking about Johnny, they'll say, "You see that picture over there? That's Johnny." And they'll have a picture of Johnny on the wall. But they have other children. In other families, they'll say, "You see that picture in the middle over there? That's Johnny. Now, up on top is Mary, our oldest daughter, and to the right is Jenny, our youngest daughter, and there's Mark, our other son." And right away, what that conveys to the other children is that these are the children in our family, and all of us are special. But when only the picture or the belongings of the deceased child are on display or made evident, that reinforces the other children's view that I'm not as special as the one who died. So parents can do little things, like display all of their children's pictures, that then reinforce the idea of this is a family and everyone belongs and we're all special. Now these are all things that parents are the best ones to do, and they're often the ones who can do all of these things for children the best. But when they're grieving, they're often not capable. Well, they're capable, but they're just not able at that moment, that time. So I often suggest to parents that they identify another adult, perhaps an aunt, an uncle, a grandparent, the next door neighbor, the mother of Mary's best friend, someone, a scout leader, a Sunday school teacher, just someone that the child knows, who is then asked to have some responsibility for this bereaved child. For example, making sure that at the funeral, they sit with them. If the child wants to leave, this person is prepared to say, "Sure, if you want to go, I'll come out with you." Someone who'll take the child to a movie, make sure that if the parents cannot go, they're willing to maybe attend his school play. Just another adult who can devote some special attention to the child, not to replace the parents, but just to supplement what the parents could do during these difficult times. And I think with all of that, then hopefully we can make the lives of these children a little bit better.